guys ready? Back, Jamie, I don't know when we met exactly. Where'd you go? There you are. But I know we, I'll come over where you are. We, I think it was probably Facebook and friends that we have that are mutual. And just begin to hear things about Jamie. He said, I think he texted me, emailed Facebook. I don't know what it was. But he said, let's get together. We had lunch across the street. And we just got to start getting to know each other. A year ago, about this time, I think it was right around this time, we did an Activate Love here during the 40 Days of Hope. And I felt deep within my heart because of some of the transition we've been going through as a church family at Crosspoint, that it was time for us to once again catch the fire of what it means to not only express our passion in the house of God, but when we walk out those doors, we begin to walk with the confidence, the assurance, and the fire and power of God inside of us, the dunamis of God, that when we walk on the streets, we walk into our neighborhoods, we walk into the marketplace, we walk into your job, your cubicle, we walk into that schoolroom, wherever it may be, that you begin to allow God to activate the thing that's inside of you, which is the glory and presence of the Father, and you begin to love people like you've never loved them before. And as I begin to get to know this guy, I begin to realize he carries something that's very special that we all need. And I believe in impartation. I believe what he carries, we can receive. And this morning, I'm convinced if you'll be patient, you won't get like antsy and want to get out, but you say, God, give me what you want to give me this morning. I believe you'll leave differently today because of the word, because of the stories, and because of the impartation that's here today. So if you're ready, I want you to do me a favor, and I want you to welcome my friend Jamie Weston as he comes this morning. Jamie, come, my friend.
Man, it's strong right now, dude.
Thank you.
It's strong right now.
Hey, is there a, can I get a stool, possibly?
A stool? Yeah.
I forgot to tell Chris. Oh, there we go. Yeah.
Gosh, is this working? Yeah. Gosh, thank you so much. Wow. So fun. I love the energy here. And man, I mean, the worship, come on, right? I mean, will the worship team stand up, please? Come on, let's bless them. So good. I mean, so good. Thank you, guys. Thank you. You took us on a journey this morning to a place that we like. So it's a real privilege to be here with you today. I'm going to make a few little changes here so I can get this sorted out. I've got a kind of a bad back, so I need to sit sometimes from time to time. And, you know, people ask me sometimes or look at me funny because they say, well, what do you mean you got a bad back? Aren't you the healing guy, you know? And I'm like, yeah, you know, I don't know. And they say, well, how does that work? And I say, well, I don't know, you know. The back's not the boss. Jesus is the boss. Pain's not the boss. Jesus is the boss. And I know that in heaven I have a new spinal cord. I actually have seen it. I had this experience some time back. I was wasn't sure if I was awake or asleep, kind of half dreaming, and I felt like this figure came and took me up into heaven, I think. We went up, and there was this hallway. It was all white. The walls were white. The ceiling was white. The floor was white. And this figure was next to me. I knew I didn't need to turn and look because I already recognized the presence of who it was. And we were walking down this hallway, and there was a door on the side. Came up to this door, and he opened the door and went in. This room was the size of 10 Costcos. I mean, it was 10 Costcos wide and 10 Costcos tall. And there were racks everywhere, racks and racks and racks and racks, filling this gigantic warehouse. And I couldn't see from the door what they were, and the figure led me over to one rack, and as I got close to the rack, I realized it was a rack of spinal cords. They were all hanging on this rack, kind of like, you know, like a dry cleaner, how they have those things that go, all those things. That's what it was like, only there were all these spinal cords hanging, and I looked around, and here's feet, and here's organs over here. There's racks of stuff there, and one of the cords One of the spinal cords was glowing and making this kind of trippy noise, like woo woo woo, you know. And I just knew that's mine. It's mine. So I've got a new one in heaven, and I hope to have it sooner than later. But every time there's a word of knowledge for a back healing or pain or whatever, I mean, I go for it. And one of these days, I'm gonna get it. In the meantime, I'm not gonna let my back keep me from bringing healing to as many people as I can as I go about my business. You know, if anything, it only qualifies me more because I get it. I understand pain. I understand limitations, you know. So anyway, it's a privilege to be here. You know, I can't tell you how much I appreciate Barry and just the little short time I've known him. You know, I feel like he leaves a trail of honey behind him. And I just like to be around him because it's so darn sweet, you know. I get a spiritual sugar rush just being around him. He's so sweet, and but with the sweetness, you know, he's got decades worth of experience that I respect, and there's a strength and a statesmanship that Barry walks in that is really awesome, and it's just a privilege, you know, to be able to hang out and to join you all today. So my pastors, Mike and Barney Burns, up at Beach Chapel, Encinitas, send their greetings as well, and they're a great bunch. You know, they let me come and go, and they're not controllers. They're facilitators and empowerers like your staff. You know, so it's great to be free to be who we are in Christ and do what we're called to do in Christ. And anyway, they send their greetings. My wife is here today, Colette. Will you stand up? I want people to know this is my little wife, Colette. She's cute. Thank you. She takes good care of me. She helps me remember my wallet and my cell phone and, you know, all the things that I forget on a regular basis. So, and then I have some friends here as well. Some of them you'll meet in a little bit. You know, I saw several people. My friend Milton's here and Aaron's here and Michael Griffin's back over here. And, you know, it's good to see some of you that I know well and some of you that I know only by sight and some of you that I might recognize your face from your Facebook picture, but you don't look quite the same as you do on Facebook, so what's up with that? Anyway. My wife and I moved. You can tell I'm not a professional speaker. I don't have a church. You know, I'm not a pastor in that sense. I mean, I'm just a guy who takes this Christianity real seriously, and that's the truth. If you know me, that's the truth. And I appreciate the chance to share with you. We moved here about 4 years ago, and we landed in Escondido, and a little over 4 years ago. And shortly after we moved here, there was a series of wildfires across the hills that were destructive. And I remember seeing on TV and on video accounts of those wildfires. How many of you remember that? Remember seeing that? I mean, you see people standing out in the streets, you know, little kids in their pajamas with their stuffed bear, you know, and somebody has a suitcase full of something, you know, as they're standing outside their house that's completely gone or having been made to leave to evacuate so that they could avoid being burnt. They just left everything, you know. And I'll never forget those pictures. One thing about those pictures that spoke to me made me realize what people really think is important. You know, if your house is on fire and you have only 10 minutes to grab something, you're going to grab what's the most important thing. What are you going to grab? Your son. Absolutely. Absolutely. You got 10 minutes. Let's say your son is mobile. He's going to make it out on his own. What are you going to grab? The Bible? Pictures. Right. Yeah. Passport. Right. We have a little box at home that's a little firebox. It's got our passports and all the paperwork in that and stuff, you know. And so that would be something that, we'd go for. I would have said, back in the day, I would have said I would have grabbed pictures too, except now my pictures, we're pretty much digital. We've digitized them, so they're all on my computer. So if I grab my computer, I got all my filing cabinets, my book work, you know, blah, 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 blah. But if you have 5 minutes and your house is on fire, 10 minutes and your house is on fire, that situation helps you real quickly prioritize what's the most important thing in life. What's the most important to you? And with your limited capacity, what are you going to carry as you leave? What can you carry out in that 10 minutes? And see, you guys, listen. Maybe it's more real to me because I'm 58, okay? And I've got maybe 3 decades left. So that talks to me. Talks to me about stewardship, you know? What am I going to do with the rest of this life you've given me, God? But I don't care if you're 58 or 18. You've only got a limited capacity to carry in life. That 10 minutes when your house is on fire is very much like the span of your life compared to eternity. No, it is. Really. I tell you this. On your deathbed, you'll look back on your life and it will seem like 10 minutes. And in that situation, people ask themselves, did I do what was important? Did I carry the right thing? See, that's a choice we can make now. We don't have to wait and look back with regret. We can choose now what's important to carry, so that when we get there, we will have done well. That's a choice we can make. Now, when Jesus was here, he spoke into that very issue, okay? Jesus showed up on the scene. It was complex. His people were mired in layers and layers and layers of law. They had multiple types of leadership. Pharisees and Sadducees telling them different things to do, different value systems, different dynamics. They had laws that covered everything. Every aspect of their life was legislated in. They were watching each other, and some people were watching over them, and they had this whole regimented system of punishments and rewards, and, you know, it was a real mess. It was very, very complicated. In some ways, very much like the life we live today. And Jesus showed up in that situation. And he spoke into that situation in regards to what's the most important thing. And he did it in Mark 12, 38 to 34. 28 to 34. I'm going to read this. One of the teachers of the law came and heard them debating. Noticing that Jesus had given them a good answer, he asked of them, of all the commandments, which is most important? The most important one, answered Jesus, is this. Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God. The Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all of your heart and all of your soul and with all of your mind and with all of your strength. The second is this, love your neighbor as yourself. There's no commandment greater than these. Well said, teacher, the man replied. You are right in saying that God is one and there is no other but him. To love him with all your heart and with all your understanding and with all your strength, and to love your neighbor as yourself, is more important than all the burnt offerings and sacrifices. So this was a Pharisee, a lawyer, having a conversation with Jesus. This is before the cross. The guy was not a Christian. Even then, they understood that love was the most important thing. And Jesus brought a real fine point to it. And Jesus saw that he answered wisely. He said to him, you're not far from the kingdom of God. And from then on, no one dared ask him any more questions. So Jesus told us we got to do 2 things. He said, if we do these 2 things, we do what's important. And everything else is taken care of. We have to love God with everything we've got. And we have to love each other extravagantly. Okay. So what does it mean to love God with everything we have? What does that mean? What does that look like? I'm sorry? Okay, a level of surrender to be able to give up what he's asking of you. What does it look like for us to love God with all of our heart, mind, soul, and strength? Obedience? Yes. I think if we're loving God, we will experience joy. But what's the substance? What's the expression? If I'm supposed to love God with all my heart, mind, soul, and strength, how do I do that? Having faith. We do it by faith, but what do we do? Let's get practical. Pray. Intimate relationship. See, I think what we experienced this morning here with this amazing worship band, I think that's pretty near loving God with all your mind, heart, soul, and strength. I think worship is an extravagant affection of love to our Father that includes our mind, our bodies are included, our strength is included, our soul is engaged. Worship, I believe, is the expression, the full expression of love to the Father. Just a simple relational worship. The intimacy we receive in worship, or I should say we experience in worship. There's an exchange of affection that even takes place there that has to do with loving him. So we love God. We've at least got a handle on that. What does it mean to love our neighbor as ourselves? What does that really mean? See, I know how to smile and wave to my neighbor. I know how to be pleasant to my neighbor. But I don't really know how to love them. What does it mean to love our neighbor? I realized, you know, I used to live in Las Vegas, and I came to a point in Las Vegas where I realized, you know what? Not only am I loving my neighbor, I'm getting real good at ignoring my neighbor. We would pull into our garage. I mean, the only time you ever saw your neighbor was the car entering or leaving the garage. No, honestly, for years I lived next to people I never talked to, ever, not once. I say to my shame, I never talked to them. Very good at ignoring them. I understand loving my neighbor is an idea, a good idea, but somehow that gets put on the back burner in terms of, oh, I need to worship, I need to pray, I need to do this, I need to serve, I need to. It's not the most important thing. Love God and love people. Love God and love people. These years go quicker all the time. Every year that goes by, my next year goes faster. When I turned 54, I realized, you know what? I'm going to get serious about this. I'm going to begin to explore this. And one day I walked out of my front door in Escondido and I went out to try to love my neighbor in a meaningful way. And I lived on the edge of the ghetto there and I couldn't talk to my neighbors because I don't speak Spanish. So I was a little hindered in that, but there's somebody on the street corner with a sign. A homeless person. I could talk to them, so I did. And begin to strike up a conversation. And the next thing I know, I find myself praying for some people and talking to people. And within a week or two of doing that, you know, met my first person that was really sick and just prayed for them, you know, and the Holy Spirit healed them. And I'm like, what? Is it that easy? Yeah, it is. It is. Met a lady in the park. She was face down in the grass. Completely, she was passed out drunk in Escondido, and went over to her had some water, and I set a water down and got back a little bit because somebody like that, you know how they're going to wake up. She was a big woman too, you know. I don't want her. I mean, she, you know. So I sat down and said, "Are you okay?" And she picked up her head like this and looked at me, and her hair was all tangled, and there's grass in her hair, and the grass imprints on her cheek, you know. And she was a mess. And she pulls herself up, and she sits there, and she goes, "Oh, I feel so bad." And I thought to myself, "Yeah, you sure do. You earned that one, didn't you? I mean, I could smell the alcohol, you know. You worked on that, you know. That's a humdinger you got going there. That belongs to you, all right, that hangover does." But I found myself saying, "You know what, can I just pray for you?" And she said, "Yeah." And she's drinking that water. And so I reached out my hand, and here's what happens. When you reach out your hand to somebody, that's what they always do. People ask me all the time, "How do you approach somebody?" Well, you walk up to them and put your hand out. That's the secret. There's no secret. The secret is just approaching people. And I took her hand and prayed for her, and her eyes popped open, and she says, "It's gone." And she sat up, and she was completely sober. And her eyes were clear. And I'm like, "Are you sure?" She says, "Yes, my headache's gone. I feel fine. What is this?" So I talked to her about Jesus and shared Jesus with her, and we exchanged numbers. And some weeks later, she called me, and I took her to treatment. I never heard back from her. I don't know whatever happened to her, you know, but I just was willing to go up to her and connect with her. I just was trying to figure out how to love my neighbor. I couldn't talk to my neighbors that lived around me. And so I realized this, you know what? A neighbor isn't somebody that lives near you. A neighbor is somebody that is near you. Which means that you are a walking neighborhood. Okay, remember the Good Samaritan? Jesus said, the guy says, "Okay, well, who's my neighbor?" And then Jesus told the story of the Good Samaritan. The Good Samaritan wasn't at home. He was out in public. Somebody on a sidewalk that he was walking by was his neighbor. So I realized, you know what? I got this proximity around me. It's about 60, 70 feet. Wherever I go, if you get in that 60, 70 feet radius, you qualify. You're a sitting duck for God's goodness. If I don't get you, Holy Spirit might, you know, going to get you somehow or another. We're going to try to find a way to unpack goodness for you in a way that's meaningful, connect with you in a way that's real. Okay. I'm not an evangelist. I'm just a guy that takes his Christianity seriously. I'm really not an evangelist, you guys. I just take it seriously, and I'm taking as many people with me as I can. I'm going to stir this up in as many people as I can. Because I think if we would all just take our Christianity seriously, we could stop praying for revival and become the revival ourselves. All it takes is a room full of this many people. That's all it takes. That's all it takes. Now, I appreciate praying for revival. Okay, I'm down with that. I get it. But come on, let's put some feet on this thing, right? It's not rocket science. It's not hard, you know? Okay. Met a woman named Michelle a while back in the street. She was sitting in her car, and talked with her. Got a little download for her, and this was in Oceanside. Talked to her, and she opened right up, man. It was some true stuff about some stuff she'd been through, and she wanted to get out of her car and talk to us, and she got out, and she was kind of moving like this, and so I ended up praying for her. And can you put that video of Michelle? The video guy is around here. Oh, no, that's not the one. That's it. Uh-oh. Well, It's important to keep things like that sorted out, you know, as you go, right? Don't want people getting the wrong idea. So fun, right? We just stopped to talk to this lady sitting in her car, you know. It turned into a full-on deal right out there in the streets of Oceanside. I began to engage with people, with friends, and we began to go out just to explore this, just for fun, as an adventure. We started going out every week, just for a couple hours to walk around town. Let's just see what happens. Let's see what we can unpack, you know. And now we're going on the fourth year. You know, and now not only are we doing it in Oceanside, but also in Encinitas, we're starting to go out. And not only that, but we also go out on the beach on Saturdays and put up a little prayer tent that has a sign that says spiritual readings, dream interpretation, soul cleansing, healing, you know. So some people come in and they're headed in the right direction, but they're expecting a whole different deal. And Holy Spirit gets them, you know. We had this guy come in, yeah, I need my chakras lined up, you know. And we're like, oh, we know the guy to line those chakras up. Come on, man. And Holy Spirit clobbered him real good. Not only that, but healed his ankle. And he walked out, and he didn't know whether he was coming or going, you know. He thought Jesus was one of many, you know, one of many. And he walked out with a whole different understanding of who Jesus is. Just willing to get out there and explore a way to love people. See, the most loving thing I can do to somebody that's sick is bring healing to them. Somebody that's stuck in hope, the most loving thing I can do is to give them a word of encouragement. Somebody's carrying too many groceries, they don't need a word of encouragement. They need somebody to help them carry their groceries. It's all the same. It all qualifies. You hold the door open for that little old lady that's looking miserable going into the drugstore, you might be the one that changes her day. Maybe she's on her way to pick up a prescription. She's been saving up prescriptions. This is the last prescription she needs to take enough medication to put herself out. She may have been in pain for years. And perhaps you holding the door open for her, and she looks up at you and says, thank you. And you say, you're welcome. You don't look too happy today. Can I just bless you with a quick prayer? She says, well, yes. And you just bless her and she goes about her business, that may change the course of her day. Just holding the door open for a little old lady and a quick prayer. It's just about loving people. I have some friends here with me that do this real well, is real, real well. And so April, will you come and share? This is my friend April. April's love on two feet. She's the real deal. She is.
Wow.
Nobody gets away from April.
It's really fun. It's really fun. I wanted to share a story, just kind of to encourage you that everyone can do this, and it can be something that it's really hard. I understand. It's really difficult. Like, you know, Jamie talks, and I'm very different than Jamie. We're very the same, but we're also very different, which is really good because we get to go out in groups together and learn from each other. But I also understand that it can be really, like, nerve-wracking, right? So I've been doing this for a long time, a couple years now. And just the other day, I was in the office. I work in the office one day a week, and when I was there, there was this woman who I work with, and I've worked with her for more than 10 years. So I know her really well, right? I know that she doesn't believe the same things I do. She's like of a whole nother faith. But I have a good relationship with her. I have a great relationship with her. And she says to me, how are you doing? And I said, I'm doing great. I'm like, how are you? And she says, my shoulder hurts so bad. So tense. I'm so stressed out. And I'm thinking to myself, oh my gosh, I have the answer. Like, I know what to do and I know how to help her. But then all those thoughts start coming in. Oh no, she doesn't believe what you believe. Oh no, you got to come see her next week. What is she going to say to you? What if she denies you? What if she says, oh no, 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 you can't pray for me. Don't touch me. Then what are you going to do? You have this awkward relationship. All this stuff is going through my head. And then I'm like, oh, well. Literally, like, oh, well, okay. Well, I'll just you know, deal with that when it comes, and I'm sure it'll be okay. And then I just go for it, because what happens is while all this stuff's happening in my head, I really feel like God stirs up this compassion in me, and he like does something where I just can't say no. And I'm like, okay, let's do this. And I say to my friend, I say, can I pray for you? I'd love to pray for you to have all of that pain go. And she looks at me and she goes, yes. And I was like, okay. You're always so nervous. You're never sure what's going to happen. But she said, yes. I prayed for her. We went about our day. And it was a very simple prayer. It was just, pain. I just tell you to leave right now. And I just pray, Father, that you just come with your peace and relax all of her muscles, all of her spine, just, you know, really loving and caring and gentle to her. And she just like looked at me like, okay, and we could both feel the presence, but I don't say anything because I'm kind of like, okay, let's just let this lie. Let's see how this works, because I'm still going to be in the office. 3 hours later, she comes up to me and she says, I just want you to know, I feel so good. All of this pain is gone. And I'm like, yay!
So good. Good job, April, and good job, Jesus. So good. See, there's this gigantic barrier of intimidation most of us face when it comes to taking our faith out into public, because we call it taking our faith out into public. Listen, every time you go out, if you go out into public, you're already taking your faith out in public. The barrier of intimidation is a joke. It's all in our mind. It's a construct by the enemy to keep us trapped in our own little world, in our own little houses. It's not real. It's like the facade on the spooky house at the carnival that looks so scary until you walk around the side and look behind it, and it's just a little single wide trailer there. It's just plywood and paint, scary noises and smoke. It's not real. It's not real, you guys. But it's keeping you from bringing the love and power of God to the people in your life. We got to pull that thing down. We got to push through that thing. Step over it, walk around it, dismantle it, however you're going to deal with it, deal with it, and start going after it. See, we were never meant to be safe. Safety's not, okay, you know, are we, isn't it dangerous to, you know, get out in public with your stuff? Safety's really highly overrated, you guys. Listen, the church was never meant to be a place of safety from the world. The church instead was meant to be a place from which to affect the world, even to assault it with his love. A need for safety that insulates me from experiencing the fullness of life and purpose in Christ isn't safety at all. It's a robber. Jesus didn't come to make just to make us good little boys and girls. And he did not come to make us comfortable. This is the truth. He came to make us absolutely, completely, fully alive. That's why he came. I came that you might have life and life abundant. He came to reconcile mankind to the Father and to make us ambassadors of that reconciliation. The life that we carry affects those around us. I meet people all the time that aren't hungry for Jesus. Okay, that's not my job. That's the Holy Spirit's job. I'm still going to love you. I'm going to love you anyway. In fact, I'm going to love you more. So the next time somebody approaches you when you're ready, you will not have been inoculated against the gospel But instead, we'll be more open to it. Met a lady in public a while back that was pretty unsafe. My friend and I were walking down the sidewalk in Oceanside, and here's this lady in sitting in one of those little electric wheelchairs, and she was another big lady. I get all these big ladies, you know, and she had some bags and stuff around her, and she was sitting on the corner, and she was yelling, shouting, screaming profanities, and I mean, we could hear her a half a block away. My friend and I were looking at her, and we're like, okay, what do we do, you know? We actually had been out talking to people and trying to love on some people. We hadn't really had any luck that day. So here's this lady, and we thought, I think we're thinking about crossing the road, you know, going around her. This is when we're going to detour around. And but we approached her, and she was clueless. She was tuned out, she didn't even know we were there. She was just blah, 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 blah. And she paused for a breath, and she looked over at us, and I started cracking up. I just started laughing at her. She goes, "What's so funny?" I found myself saying, "Well, look at you, how intense you are. You're so intense out here sitting on the sidewalk. What are you so intense about?" And she tells us this story about her landlord had done this and that and blah, 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 and she's mad and this and that and blah, blah, blah. And we started talking to her, and she opened up, and come to find out, she actually was a believer, I mean, at least a believer, you know. So we said, "Well, why are you in this chair? And can you put up that wheelchair picture one, please?" Here she is here. This is her. That's me talking to her. My friend snapped this picture. And she said that she had been in an accident at work. She had crushed her spine. Some big shelves, metal shelving, had fallen on her at work, and she crushed her spine. And she had, in this wheelchair, she had those little foot things, and she had perfectly white men's tube socks on. They were brand new, and you could tell from looking at them that the woman just didn't walk. They were perfectly beautiful white socks. And so she's sitting in this wheelchair, and we just asked if we could pray for her. And she said, "Yeah." So we just prayed for her and released healing to her, commanded her spine to mend in Jesus' name, and prayed for her a little bit, and then asked her if she felt anything. She said, "No." I said, "Okay, well, are you willing to just see if there's a difference?" She says, "Okay." So she puts her little foot things down. She starts to get up out of her wheelchair. "Can you put wheelchair picture number two up, please?" She starts walking around on the street. She's going, "I can't do this. I can't do this. I can't do this." And she's walking around in circles in the street, shaking her head. And then she looks at us and she says, "But my feet are still numb." I said, "Okay." You know, she went over and commanded the nerves to mend. And she says, "I feel the rocks in my socks. I feel the rocks in the soles of my feet." You know, Jesus restored this woman right out on a street corner by the bus depot, who moments before had been shouting profanities. That's how he does. Jesus is not afraid of people. Jesus isn't afraid of profane language. It's offensive, but he's not afraid. Are you kidding? He hung out with Peter and those guys, man. I mean, come on, they're fishermen, professional fishermen. I mean, have you ever been around guys like that? Golly. See, I was in the trades. I know what it's like. Now, not everybody that we pray for gets healed. Okay. There's a wheelchair pick guy. Can you put that up? Or no, the guy with the crutches pick. This guy here was a guy that we met out here on the beach doing the prayer tent, and we had met him before, and he had fallen down a hill and broken his ankle, and we'd had been building a relationship with him over some weeks, he and his son, and he came to us for prayer because he knew that, you know, God did stuff, and so we prayed for him, and he did not get healed. He did not get healed, but we spent probably 45 minutes or an hour with him, encouraging him and blessing him and praying for him, and he got loved real good. Now, this guy ended up actually being completely restored. He was an alcoholic who had left his wife back in Georgia and come out with his son and was just drinking himself to death. God got a hold of this guy. And he ended up going back to Georgia, was restored to his family. His son, I'm still in touch with his son over Facebook. This is some years ago. I'm still in touch. His son went back, got married, has a kid now. These were people living in the ravine in Oceanside. Homeless people, drinking themselves to death. God got a hold of them. The power of love. Love is enough. Love is enough. My friend Sherry Brown's going to share a quick story with you, and then we're going to wrap up.
Thank you, Jamie. So good. When I asked the Lord, what do you want me to share? He reminded me of the story. It was an amazing love story. If you could put the picture up, I put it into a collage so we wouldn't have to go from picture to picture. In 2010, shortly after God's love rocked my world, I turned on the computer and Yahoo News said there was a story about a little church in Warsaw, Ohio. Anybody know where Warsaw is? Okay, neither did I. Oh, you did. Okay. It's a very tiny little hole in the wall place. But God knew where it was. So there's this little church in Warsaw, Ohio that was picketing a little strip club. And the strip club had 6 dancers in it. So we're talking a teeny tiny little community. They had been picketing this strip club for 2 years. Every Friday night, every Saturday night, all the men in the church would leave their families, leave their wives, leave their kids, and go picket this club. And so why it ended up making the news was because this particular Sunday, the dancers decided to picket the church. So the dancers got their lawn chairs, sat in front of the church, and began to picket the church. And they were wearing bikinis, so it made the news and everything. Well, as soon as I saw that, it broke my heart that the church was misrepresenting God's love. So I said, God, what are we going to do about this? And he told me, I'm going to go to Warsaw, Ohio, and share with the girls how much he loved them. So within 2 hours, I was on a plane, and I met a friend there. So I flew 6 hours. She drove 6 hours. She was coming from Michigan. And those little pink gifts in the first corner are the gifts we brought the girls. In there were pink Bibles, the father's love letter, and little jewelry, lip glosses, and stuff like that. And so Friday night, we go to the club, and the church is outside picketing. And they told us it was closed. We can't go in there. And I'm thinking it's 10 o'clock. There's no way the club's closed. So we made our way in, and it wasn't closed. So the girls, we just told them we were there to let them know how much God loved them, and we were sorry that God has been misrepresented by these men, and that's not his heart for him. And they invited us into their dressing room. The dressing room, I go to strip clubs and porn conventions all the time, but the dressing room is the best place to go when we get to, because the girls don't have their game faces on, so it's just them and us. And so we sat down with the girls and just began to pour out Papa's love for them. And they were in tears and just thanked us for coming and sharing his love. And so they asked us to come back on Saturday night. So we came back and we told them we'll bring them pizza. So we came back on Saturday night. And so that's the little club next to the gift bags is the tiny little, it's called the Foxhole, this teeny tiny little club. Those are the girls that work there. And the next picture, so right under the gift bags, is the father's love letter. When we came back on Saturday, they had the love letter, father's love letters posted in the dressing room. And the letters that we had wrote them, they were posted all over. Just basically God's love all around them. And when we came back, I asked the Lord, what do you want to do today? And he said, well, yesterday you gave him my love, and today I want you to give them the gift of salvation. And so I said, okay, so we asked the girls, invite them into a relationship with the Father. And by the way, right before I got to the club, the Lord said to get 4 pizzas. So I got 4 pizzas. We get to the club. He said, leave 2 in the car. And I'm like, okay. So we go into the club, bring the pizza, you know, and the girls are just like, thank you so much. We feel so loved. And we just said, you know, Jesus wants a relationship with you. So anyway, a few of the girls gave their life to Jesus for the first time. Two others rededicated their life. And another girl, so God is so good. Another girl said, I will let you know, I want to think about this. And she was just really hurt from the church out there. And so it was just an incredible moment. This is the first time I saw physical manifestations of the supernatural. So right after we pray and these the girls give their life to the Lord, we are all covered in glitter, glory dust. And I'd never seen anything like this before, but one of the girls that gave their life to the Lord, she was a manager. She goes, oh my gosh, what's this? We're not allowed to have glitter in the club. And the other girl I was with knew all about it. She's like, it's glory dust. Don't worry, it'll disappear later. And anyway, we were covered in it. God's glory was all in the club. And so anyway, we walk out of there, and we run into the church people, including the pastor. And I got to be honest, those were the hardest people for me to love, was because they were hating on these girls, and it broke my heart. And I was telling God, I don't even want to see them or talk to them because I'm mad at them. And he said, no, you're going to love them just as you love the girls. And so he tells me to go to my car and get the other two pizzas. So we come to them, and they said, what are you girls doing here? And I said, we just came to let the girls know how much God loves them. And they said, we've been doing that for 2 years, but it hasn't worked. And I was like, well, we did it a little different, you know. And I gave him the pizza. So the next picture is the pastor has the red shirt on. We gave him the pizza, and there were several men there. And it turns out that the men in the church were actually struggling with pornography and had some stuff going on in their own life. So a way to cover up that sin was to, like, bash everybody that was involved in it so that nobody would look at their own stuff going on. So we began to share with them the Father's heart and his love. And the pastor said, can you come back tomorrow to my church and preach? So we prayed together. And the next picture is us at the church. He gave us the pulpit. And we're sharing with this condemning church God's love for them. And it was so good. So at the very end, you know, Holy Spirit, I didn't sleep for the entire weekend. The Holy Spirit just kept downloading me. Now I need you to do this. Now I need you to do that. One thing he told me to do was order the girls in the club, JC's girls shirts, which stands for Jesus Christ girls. So I ordered them all shirts, which got shipped to them by Tuesday. So what happened was right after this message that the Lord poured out on me, I just said, if you want to do things different, if you want to love these girls better, God's way, do me a favor, stand with me. So the whole church, the pastor, they were crying, his wife was crying, they were all right here just on their knees bawling. And the pastor's wife came up to me and goes, what do I do next? And I said, now you go out the doors and you go tell those girls you're sorry and you love them. So the next couple pictures is the church going, hugging the girls, loving on them, apologizing. And the picture in the bottom corner is the pastor in the blue shirt with the tie. The other guy with the necklace on, he is the strip club owner. And they had been feuding back and forth. I mean, hated each other's guts, literally. And so God did some major reconciliation there. And then, unfortunately, when I came back to San Diego that Sunday night, at 2 o'clock in the morning, God woke me up. I'm finally going to sleep, and God wakes me up, and he goes, I need you to know something. He said, this story had made the news and all kinds of stuff. The news people were there and stuff. So God said, I need to do something, and I need you to trust me. I need to cover the pastor's eyes and cover his ears, because right now the whole community thinks you guys came in and changed this thing around, and it's me and you're getting the glory and I need to get the glory. And so he said, so don't be alarmed when he calls you tomorrow, the pastor, and tells you I've changed my mind. And so I was like, okay. And he just said, I need you to trust me. So I fall asleep. He wakes me up at 3 in the morning And he says, get up and write this down. And I'm tired. I'm so tired. He said, just get up and write this down. So I get up and I write this down. And it's a letter to the manager of the strip club. Her name was Gina. And he said, Gina is going to basically take over where we left off. She's going to take over and she's going to do what he tells her to do. And it's a very personal letter to her. So I wake up in the morning, exactly what happens. The pastor calls me and said, thank you guys for coming. I've decided to change my mind. I'm going back. I will not sleep until this club is closed down and this is the way it is. And I said, okay. I said, well, you know, I will be praying for you guys. And so the strip club owner was so mad that the pastor changed his mind. So he just said, this is going to be war. The girls are going dressed in way worse clothes than bikinis. Yeah. So anyway, the manager of the club said, we just got JC's girls t-shirts in the mail, and we are going to sit in front of the church and show the church just how much God loves them. And so the last picture is them wearing JC's girl shirts, loving the church. And so anyway, I just wanted to share that story with, God can choose the least likely to be love to anybody. So good.
Thank you, Sherry. Isn't that amazing? Listen, we are over time here. We are over time. I'm going to wrap this up immediately, okay? But listen, Ephesians, Paul tells us that each one of us were created to do good works in Christ, which he has prepared from beforehand for us to do, each one of us. Now, that means that God has an agenda for each one of us. God has a heavenly day timer with your name on it, and he's plotted out your days with good stuff for you to do as you go. You may not ever go into a strip club with the blazing light of God's love like Sherry does. You might not ever pray for somebody on the job like April did. You might not ever see a wheelchair emptied in the streets, or you might. The question is, what does it look like when you begin to unpack the Jesus in you? See, it's going to look different than it does for me. And that's necessary. God created you as he did for a reason. He gave you the gifts and abilities and talents that he gave you for a reason. It's all by design. There's this brilliant, amazing, multidimensional design that each one of you are a part of. And if you're not willing to unpack the love of God that's in you according to your shape, according to your gifts, your abilities, there are people in your life, in your world, that will never see Jesus. You may be the only gospel they ever see. And he's designed you to do it. It looks different for everybody. You're not supposed to be like me. I'm not supposed to be like you. But we're all supposed to be like Jesus. So when I'm talking about stepping into the love of God, I'm not talking about a program. I'm talking about a lifestyle. Okay? God's love isn't one thing more for me to do in my Christian life. God's love is the fabric upon which everything that I do makes sense. If we're not moving in the love of God, if we're not grounded, rooted and grounded in love, like Paul said, nothing makes sense and it all becomes works. We get busy and then we get tired. Here's what's going to happen if you start going after the power of God's extravagant love. You're going to get healed yourself, and you're going to bring it as you go. Love heals whatever it touches. Love transforms everything it touches. Love leaves nothing alone. Love is not static. Love is not an idea. Love is an action. Love is Jesus. Only thing is, in your situation, Jesus looks like you. You're going to get healed and you're going to bring it. Another thing, if you start getting grounded in the love of God, you're going to get holy and you're going to bring it. I'm telling you, I want to tell you this. I struggled with some stuff all of my life, and it actually come to a point where I had a negotiated settlement with some issues in my life. I'm just going to carry these things and deal with them and struggle with them for the rest. This is my thorn in my flesh, you know, all this nonsense. You know what? When I begin to get rooted and grounded and go after God's love, I left that stuff so far behind, I can't even see it. Listen, I come out of such profound brokenness, you can't even imagine. And you can't smell it on me. That's how good God is. He does that good a work. Love purifies what it touches. And you'll bring it. The love that you carry will make those uncomfortable around you. Not the sign that you carry. The love that you carry transforms everything it touches. Also, you'll get centered in life. The love that when we begin to go after the extravagant love of God, loving God and loving each other, we get centered in our life and anchored in our lives. Everything makes sense. All the priorities begin to line up. I don't have to juggle, is it God and then my wife and then work and all this stuff. It's not that at all. It's all God. It's all love. Of course I'm going to give my wife the time she needs. If I love her. Okay. So this next weekend, we're going to go after some of this stuff more intentionally with you guys. Friday night, I'm going to have my friend Stan Don here. We're going to do a whole evening of practical equipping on how to actually connect with people in a redemptive way, how to move in supernatural, some ways to unpack healing in public, some ways to unpack prophecy in public. We're going to learn about it, and we're going to do it. We're going to do more doing than learning. Okay, so that's Friday night, this next week. And then Saturday, all day, we're going to have a workshop. We're going to have about 45 minutes worth of exhortation. We're going to go after some things. Sherry's going to speak. I'm going to speak. Stan's going to speak. We're going to have a clinic time. We practice some stuff. We're going to have some worship and impartation. Then I'm going to have a whole squadron of team leaders present that are experienced in this, that live this in their everyday lives. They'll be there for you. And we're going to match you up with them, two or three with a team leader. And we're going to go out for a couple hours in the community and have lunch together and just love everything that moves. And you can be as engaged in that as you want to. If you want to come and watch, you come and watch. Love of God's going to get you. Before you know it, you'll be empty in wheelchairs. Okay. And then we get back together at the end of the day, tell Holy Ghost stories. So I like to just pray, and Barry, did you want to, yeah? Okay, yeah. So I would just like to pray. Will you stand with me? Are any of you down for this? I mean, if you're not, you know, that's okay. So, Holy Spirit, I'm just so aware of your presence here with us today. Let's just present ourselves to him, saints. Welcome you, Holy Spirit. Do what you do. Stir us up. Let the power of your love touch us. Transform us, move through us. We belong to you. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, and that includes La Mesa. So we know that La Mesa already belongs to you, Jesus. You paid for it. But we're the ones that get to go out and occupy. Holy Spirit, I'm asking you to push a seed of your purpose and hope into each person here that's open to you. Breathe on us today. We thank you for the power of your love and for what you're doing in this beautiful house and in La Mesa and in our region at large. We look forward to hanging out with you, Jesus, seeing your kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven.
Yeah, a couple of things we're going to do as we wrap up. Number one, Father, I come against a spirit of intimidation. I felt like for a moment, God, you said that I need to come against that on behalf of this church, on behalf of this region. Father, I bind that spirit of intimidation. It's exactly that. You're a liar. Pastor Jamie has shared that with us, and we speak it out right now. Jesus, we thank you in advance for the bold sons and daughters, the spirit of courage, the spirit of hope, the spirit of bravery, God, is coming on your children. And I speak and I declare it with the authority of heaven over this house, over this region. Let the days of the love revolution increase right now in Jesus' name. Jesus' name. I really believe there's a number of us this morning that are so inspired and so motivated that I just want to speak this over you. I really believe that God's going to raise up, I'm going to use this word very loosely, but some evangelists that are going to begin to go into the streets, into the neighborhoods, even into the marketplace, and they're going to have great favor on their life. They're going to speak. You know, sometimes we speak and we go to ourselves and we think, that didn't make sense. But I know this happens in the spiritual, in the natural as well, that there's times I've spoken a word, a message over a church or our church, and what I spoke was heard very differently than what came out of my lips. Because I believe, Holy Spirit, you will allow people to hear what needs to be heard. So even if we don't wax eloquent in our expression of love to those that we're ministering to, I know they can hear what you want them to hear. So God exponentially increased the favor over your sons and daughters as they begin to release the goodness of God over the city and over this region in Jesus' name.